into account that our strongest allies and our greatest army already is within the enemy camp. But these captive peoples behind the iron and bamboo curtains have learned the hard way that although American leaders talk a good line about world freedom, when the chips are down, they don't deliver the goods. You want to meet some bitter people? Talk to a few Hungarian refugees or some Cubans whose loved ones were abandoned at the Bay of Pigs. I'll never forget one conversation with a young Hungarian freedom fighter. He described how for months prior to the revolt, American radio transmitters in Europe had been beaming broadcasts into Hungary, encouraging the people to revolt and promising full support. Now, to men and women who are fighting for their lives, full support does not mean moral support and good wishes. It means guns and ammunition. And so when the revolt finally broke out, this young man told how sure he and his friends were that America would come to their help. After all, we promised. Each day, they'd radio a desperate plea to the free world for military supplies, particularly bazookas and hand grenades, something that would be effective against Soviet tanks that were then forming an iron ring around Budapest. And then they'd go to the airport and wait. Finally, on about the fourth day, an American transport plane circled the field for landing. And when they looked up and saw that big, beautiful American star on the side of the plane, he said they began to cry like babies, because at last the Americans had come through. When the plane landed, they were so anxious to find out what kind of weapons had been sent, they scrambled aboard and began to pry open the wooden crates with their bare hands. And do you know what they found? Powdered milk. They were stunned. They couldn't believe it. And then one of them got the idea that maybe the Americans had been clever enough to camouflage their shipment by hiding hand grenades or at least bullets inside the cans. And so they got a can opener and began desperately to open one can after another. But each was the same, powdered milk. Well, actually, it was disclosed later that at the same time we were declining to offer any real help to the Hungarian freedom fighters, our State Department sent a communique to communist Yugoslavia, and thus indirectly to the whole communist world, that made it clear we would not take any action to prevent the Soviets from putting down this revolt in Hungary. The message read as follows. The United States looks with disfavor upon governments unfriendly to the Soviet Union on the borders of the Soviet Union. And since Hungary lies on the border of the Soviet Union, with that assurance of non-intervention from the United States, the fate of the freedom fighters of Hungary was sealed. But returning to the young refugee telling the story, after describing the scene at the airport, he looked at me and he said, "When we needed your help, you chose instead to be friends with the Soviets. My people will never trust the United States again, or at least as long as the American flag flies over your embassy in Budapest as a reminder to us that your ambassador of goodwill continues to exchange cordial greetings with our hated masters. On the day that you lower your flag and call home your ambassador, on that day, my people will fight again." And these are just about his exact words. I've had reason to reflect on that statement many times since, and I've come to the conclusion that if the captive peoples behind the iron and bamboo curtains were ever given any reason to believe that we were really on their side instead of seeking an accommodation with their masters, it's my conviction that they would take courage, rise up as one, and topple their communist regimes the same way they were imposed in the first place from the inside, and we wouldn't have to fire a shot. But we do have to stop helping the communists. We do have to stop dignifying their leaders as legitimate representatives of the people. And we do have to stand firm for a change and declare openly in word and deed our uncompromising dedication to victory over communism everywhere in the world. Now, ladies and gentlemen, that probably would be an easy place for me to end. Three cheers for victory. But it's not quite that simple. I'd be less than honest with you if I closed it at this point, because we still are missing one final but very important consideration, Even though it's true that the bomb is primarily a psychological weapon today, and even though the chances are microscopically small that the bomb would be used in either our victory or our defeat, nevertheless, we can't entirely rule out the possibility. No matter how remote, it still exists. So, now what is our position? Do we give up the whole idea and return blindly to the hope that somehow we can coexist, at least for a little while longer, so we can enjoy life to the fullest in the time we have left? I think not. I have too much faith in the American people once they fully understand what the choice is. Putting it very bluntly, ladies and gentlemen, if we are not willing to risk our lives, our beautiful cities, and all the material things which we value for those principles in which we believe, then how can we have the audacity to send our sons into a foreign battlefield and ask them to give their lives for those principles? Are their lives any less precious than ours? As far as I'm concerned, when we send that first American soldier into battle, when we first ask him to be willing to lay down his life for us, we put the whole nation right on the line behind him. And if we are not willing to do this, then this is no longer the home of the brave, nor much longer the land of the free. Well, these are the heavy thoughts I leave with you. And I don't know quite how to close this presentation without running the risk of sounding corny, because the sentiment I want to express here has often been ridiculed as being corny. But to me, it's far from that. It's an article of faith that needs to be reaffirmed in the public mind openly, without shame or embarrassment. And it's simply this. As Americans today, we are truly a privileged people in a privileged land. But with our blessings come responsibilities, and with responsibilities come risks. The challenge of our time is that we must accept both the responsibilities of our blessings and the risks involved in defending them for ourselves and for future generations. And we must do this without hesitation if we are to be worthy benefactors of that precious heritage of freedom passed on to us through the epic sacrifices of those who have gone before. Now, that is not flag waving, and it is not cliched patriotism. That's a simple statement of the obligations of citizenship in this glorious land, our land, which with God's help, we shall preserve.